inspire you. If you would just turn with me to your Bibles to Psalm chapter 42 and 43. It's going to be quite a read. And it reads, "As a deer pants for the flowing streams, so pants my soul for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? My tears have been food day and night, while they say to me all the day long, 'Where is your God?' These things I remember as I pour out my soul. How would I go with the throng and lead them in procession for the house of God with glad shouts and the song of praise, a multitude keeping festival? Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him, my salvation and my God. My soul is cast down within me. Therefore, I remember you from the land of Jordan and of Hermon and the Mount Mizar. Deep calls to deep at the roar of your waterfalls. All your breakers and your waves have gone over me. By day, the Lord commands his steadfast love, and at night his song is with me, a prayer of the God of my life. I say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why do I go mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? As with a deadly wound in my bones, my adversaries taunt me, while they say to me all the day long, 'Where is my God?' Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God, for I shall praise him, my salvation and my God." Chapter 43. "Vindicate me, O God, and defend my cause against all an ungodly people. From the deceitful and unjust men, deliver me. For you are the God in whom I take refuge. Why have you rejected me? Why do I go about mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? Send out light and your truth. Let them lead me. Let them bring me to your holy hill and to your dwelling. Then I will go to the altar of God and to God my exceeding joy, and I will praise you with the lyre of God, my God. Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God, for I shall praise him again, and my salvation and my God." This is the word of the Lord.
Fam, it's been an awesome morning so far. I'm excited to open up God's word with you. Thank you, Mpudumo, for hosting us like a pro this morning. Thank you, Jake and Chili and Mpo, for leading us in worship. It's been a great morning. Thank you, Lerato, also for reading a marathon. It was her first read, and she tackled a marathon. Yeah, cheers. When? Where? Why? How long? Questions, fam. Questions. As sure as we have seasons, you'll have them. Sometimes our questions become uppercase. A little bit louder. When? Where? Why? Sometimes our questions get an emoji or two. When? Where? Why? You guys know that emoji? I usually use it for I don't know. But I mean, it's why. Have you ever been there? Are you there now? Sometimes these questions weigh us down to such an extent that we can say our souls are cast down. We can say our souls are downcast. Our souls are troubled. Our souls are turbulent. Our souls are stormy. They can weigh us down so much that we feel my soul is depressed. And I'm not talking about depressed in the psychological sense. I'm talking about depressed in a spiritual sense. It's when you feel your soul is unhappy. Or maybe the best way to describe it is to say, in the deepest part of you, you have no hope. You feel weak. English is a great language, so they've got so many words to describe this. Check this one. You feel debilitated. Have you ever been there? common symptoms of this place is you can't pray. You won't pray. You feel like life is on autopilot. And you're really good in putting your mask on. Because you just don't want to go there. How's it? No! Lekker. Yeah. Ah, cool, man. Glad to hear that. Meanwhile, behind the mask, your soul is depressed. You lack joy. You lack passion. You lack enthusiasm. You're not thirsting for God's presence. You're not desiring the Bible. You're not enjoying singing the great songs of our faith. I want you to know this morning that you are not alone. You're not alone. Many saints through the years have experienced what we can call spiritual depression. The great Welsh preacher D. Martin Lloyd-Jones actually has a book with the title Spiritual Depression. The great English preacher Charles Spurgeon, there's a whole book called Spurgeon's Sorrows on his own spiritual depression that was mainly due to his health problems. Do you guys remember Elijah? Was he always good and well and happy? How about our boy Moses? Did Moses always have it lekker? No, he didn't. Fam, there's a scene in 1 Kings 19 where Elijah sits under a broom tree and he says, God, take my life. I'm done. I've had it. Enough. Just kill me now. Do you guys remember those stories? This great man of God, the prophet of the Old Testament. I'm done. If the writer of Psalm 42 and 43 was here this morning, he'll say, I feel you. I know what it's like. Most people who write about these two psalms will tell you that they are actually one. Many Hebrew manuscripts actually put them together. You saw that Psalm 43 doesn't have a title, which is surprising in this book of the Psalms, because every psalm has a title. And obviously they have a common chorus, or in poetry language we call it a refrain, which is 42 verse 5, 11, and then 43 verse 5, we'll get there now. They might just have been divided to be used in the sanctuary where God's people would gather as they would sing it, like verse 1, verse 2, part 1, part 2. The writer of this psalm is a musician, we'll get to verse 4 again, who has known the joy of worship in the house of God, but is denied that privilege at this moment. It's a musician, but he's dry, he's dejected, he's overwhelmed, he's disheartened because of his inability to participate in worship at the temple. There's something that he wants and he can't get it. And it's busy killing him. We'll get to that a little bit later. He seems to be far in the north, Limpopo. I'm joking. He's in the northern part of Israel. We don't know why he can't get to Jerusalem, which is in the southern part of Israel. Many reasons for that. The psalm could be written from exile, right? They were taken out of Israel. He could be a prisoner of war. So there was a war and he was taken captive. It might be that he simply lives really far and the travel is very expensive. It might be that there's some sort of conflict between the northern part and southern part of Israel, so he can't get through it. Most likely, it's due to the fact that he's sick, that he's physically not well, and therefore he can't enter the temple. Why? Do you guys see the question? Now, he's not prevented from praying. And he's not prevented from communing with God, because that's what he's doing in the psalm, right? We just read it. But he's missing something. And the thing that he says he's missing the most is this corporate get-together, worshiping with God's people in God's house. And that is what he desires and he longs for. And he can't get it. And added to his struggle is the presence of enemies, he says, who taunts him. Nah, 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 you can't get to the temple. I'm joking, I just made up that song. But that's what taunting is. in his face, making fun of him, and then asking, where is your God? Blaspheming in his face. It's devastating, isn't it? When, where, why? This is a psalm filled with lament. It's a psalm filled with plea. And it's a psalm filled with, oh, the beautiful H word, hope. Now, note, before we get into it, this psalm writer has to preach this hope to himself, which is how he deals with his discouraged state. He preaches to himself. And he reminds himself of the character of God and the past grace of God. And when we study his life and his response, we learn a lot from it. Why? So that we can also do this when we need to press on in times that we are struggling in our own faith and that our souls feel depressed. If I can say it in plain English, he lets himself go. He speaks honestly to God. He makes himself think. He thinks of the past grace of God. He thinks of God's character. And in the end, he pulls himself together. And how does he do that? He does that by preaching to his soul three times. Now, the first two things are common in the Psalms, right? There's a lot of honesty in the Psalms. And there's also a lot of thinking of the past grace of God and his character in the Psalms. Not so much do we see people actually preaching to their own souls in the Psalms. And in these two Psalms, the person does it three times. Three times the same chorus repeats. So poetry language, it's got three stanzas with a common refrain. In stock standard vernacular English, three parts with a chorus. Okay? And the chorus is verse 11. Why are you cast down, O my soul, and why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him, my salvation and my God. That's the chorus. Now the three parts tell us why this person's soul is cast down. So I thought, seeing that that's our theme for today, let's just lead with that question. Okay, so one question, why are you cast down, O my soul? And there are the three reasons we find in these two psalms. So firstly, there's a longing for God and for participation in public worship. There's a feeling of being overwhelmed and forgotten. Ever been there? And then there's also a wanting deliverance so that this person can get what he wants. And that is to attend public worship. Now, let's discover how prayer and lament, reflection and God's past grace in his characters and preaching to his own soul gives him hope in this season. You guys ready for it? Just before we get into it, let me pray for us. Father God, thank you for your word. And thank you that your word leads us to an encounter with you, leads us to intimacy with you, and that it's a light that shines to our feet so that we can see where we go, and that it's truth that sets us free. Thank you for this amazing song written by this really downcast person that can be a blessing and a comfort to us today. And that's my prayer, Father God, is that we would be deeply comforted by your word as we work through it. May your name be glorified. Lord Jesus, may we see you and the amazing salvation that you brought us once again, more clearly and more compellingly than before. We pray that in your name. Amen. Okay, so let's look at the first one. Why is this person cast down? Because there's a longing for God and for participation in public worship. Look at the highlights with me. They'll be on the screen. So we see sons of Korah, we see the word maskil, we see a deer, we see water, we see thirst, we see life, and we see a question. My word, two verses. They are packed now, aren't they? Firstly, the sons of Korah. The sons of Korah was a group of priests, and they were in charge of the worship ministry based in Jerusalem. They were ordained or appointed by King David, and their job was lead the people in music. Now, the song, the Psalms of Korah, they have a more corporate feel than like the Psalms of David, that has a more individual feel. And they wrote 11 in total. And we are taking one of them because 42 and 43 is actually one. It says a maskil of the sons of Korah. Do you guys know what a maskil is? I also didn't know. It's actually a Hebrew word. And because the meaning of the word is not clear, most translations just don't translate it. They just leave it like that. And then we should just know what it is, you know. So maskil, it comes from a Hebrew word that means to make one wise or to instruct one. So, in plain English, this is a song that should teach you an important lesson. You guys with me? And comes from the sons of Korah. Now, the person who wrote this, we already said, has a very intense longing to be with God's people in God's house and to worship God. And we also see that this longing is for God and God only, because there are repeated references in the psalm about God throughout. Now, how does this person long for God? Like a thirsty deer expressing a deep yearning for water. There you go. Verse number one. The deer is looking for water until he finds it. And then he drinks it. And then it leads to great joy. The psalm writer says, "That is how I thirst for you, O God. My whole being pants for your presence." That's all I want. Fam, I'm a big fan of the bushveld and wildlife. If there is a deer that is thirsty, that is looking for water, that deer will not stop. Because it's an animal who has one thing in its mind, and that is the survival of him or her. And therefore, I have to get what I now need. Single-minded. Right? Focused on only one thing. You won't get an impala going, "Whew, I'm quite thirsty. I think because it's quite hot outside now, I might have a half an hour nap and then I'll look for water a little bit later." An animal will keep on looking for water until either it finds it or it dies. That is how intense that longing is. Look what Charles Spurgeon says about this psalm. There's a quote on the screen for you. "Do you know what this is? By personally having felt the same, it is a sweet bitterness. The next best thing to living in the light of the Lord's love is to be unhappy until we have it, and to pant hourly after it." Hourly? Did I say? "Thirst is a perpetual appetite and not to be forgotten. And even thus continual is the heart's longing after God. When it is as natural for us to long for God as for an animal to thirst, it is well with our souls, however painful our feelings." We may learn from this verse that the eagerness of our desires may be pleaded with God, and the more so because there are special promises for the persistent and fervent. What a quote! That's why he was such a great preacher, a wordsmith. Do you see what he says? Only God can satisfy our thirst. And the more we are aware of our thirst, and the more we long for this thirst to be quenched, the more well it will be with our souls. Jesus knew this when he was a human. Jesus sat down with a woman at the well in John 4 and he said, "I have water, and when you drink it, you will never thirst again." Per implication saying, "I can see that you parched, and that you're dry, and that you're thirsty, and that you need it. I know. I'm also a human like you. But in me, you'll find something, and that feeling will be gone, 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 gone forever." Fam, think about how beautiful it is when your thirst gets quenched on a hot day, or after some strenuous exercise, or after a long meeting when that aircon runs at 16 degrees and you feel like your whole face is drying out. Once you go gagunk, 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 for those few seconds when you have that dopamine surge in your head and your body goes, "Yay! Oh, it is well with my body." Jesus Christ says, if you believe in me, that's how you'll feel in your soul. That's how you'll feel in your soul. It doesn't matter what you're going through. When it comes to Jesus, the best way to put it is drink or die. Think about that. Whoever believes in him, says John 3, will not perish. So you either believe in him and your thirst is quenched, or you don't believe in him and you die. That's it. What does this person want? Look at the question. When shall I come and appear before God? That's what I want more than anything. He's got the temple in view. He knows that God has promised to be in the temple, there, physically and present. He can't get there. He's detached. He's isolated. He feels dejected. He longs to worship God with the people of God in the house of God. He wants this so bad that he is filled with grief. Have you ever been there? Wanting something so bad that it fills you with grief when you can't get it. Look at the highlights in verses 3 and 4. Tears. Day and night. All day long, there's the taunting. He expresses his grief. He says, I have been drinking my tears day and night. Fam, do you know what that means? That means this guy has been crying and crying and crying, and that's all he does. And while he's busy crying, he's got people standing over him, taunting him, saying, nah, 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 nah. Where's your God? High fives all around. Evil is persecuting this person. Look at what D. Martin Lloyd-Jones says. He reminds us of our enemy, who is Satan, who wants us to be cast down. Just look at this quote. The devil's one object is so to depress God's people that he can go to the man of the world and say, they are God's people. Do you want to be like that? Obviously, he says, the whole strategy of the adversary of our souls and God's adversary is so to depress us and to make us look as this man looked when he was passing through this period of unhappiness. That is the truth. All of us are under this attack. All of us. The whole time. Where is your God? The enemy asks. I don't know about you, fam, but if I hear that again and again and again and again, and it's not counted with the truth of the word, do you know what I say? Yeah. Where are you, God? It becomes the truth, but it's definitely not. His enemies conclude that God has abandoned him. Do you guys remember Job? Hey, Job, yeah, dude, listen, we've spoken, his three friends, and we think that God has abandoned you. Yeah. That's why you are where you are. So just curse him, man, because he's left you. Now, luckily, Job never did that. It seems as if God had departed from this person. My God, why have you forsaken me? The words of our own Savior on the cross tells us that this is a real feeling. It's easy for me to say, he will never leave you. He will never forsake you. Just don't believe it. As a human being, Jesus Christ himself said, I really feel like you left me now. It is a real feeling. Let us acknowledge it. Don't put the mask on. Don't feel and believe that God has abandoned you. And then when someone asks you, do you actually believe that God abandoned you? You say, no, no, not at all. No, it's not a problem. No, I don't have that problem. But you actually feel it. Say it. Acknowledge it. Our Savior did. And this psalm writer has the courage to say it. And in that place, what does he do? Look at verse 4. I remember. Oh, I remember. I remember better times. I remember times when I used to lead worship. I remember times when I was in Jerusalem, in great crowds, during great festivals, singing all the songs. You know what I mean? He goes back to that place. The Feast of Passover, the Feast of Booths, the Feast of Pentecost. Let me remind myself that I wasn't always in this space. And therefore, I won't always be in this space. There were better times. And these better times that I'm remembering now is supposed to pick me up. And then he sings the first chorus. Why are you cast down, O my soul? Turmoil. Turmoil. And then a ripper of a sermon in one line. Hope in God, for I shall again praise Him, my salvation and my God. Even though he remembers the good times, the weight isn't lifted. And as he remembers the good times, it causes him to preach to himself. And then he preaches to his soul. And that's the sermon right there. Spurgeon says, as though this were two men, the psalmist talks to himself. And then I love this line. His faith reasons with his fears. His hope argues with his sorrows. Do you guys see it? So these sorrows are. And there are fears. But there are sorrows, fears, faith, and hope. And these two are at loggerheads with one another. And then the psalmist preaches to himself. He's seeking to preach his soul out of the dumps. He is confident that the Lord will act. He knows God is faithful. Why? Look at it. I shall again. Isn't that a great statement of faith? Remember where this guy is. And he's got no guarantee, coupon, or slip, or voucher that says it'll turn tomorrow. But he says, as I remember the good times, as I remember praising God for His faithfulness, I know that I'll do it again. I know it. I know it that I know it that I know it. Why? Who is this He that I shall praise? My salvation. I know that God will save me, is what the psalmist says. I know He'll do it. And the amazing thing is that salvation, if you translate it literally in the Hebrew, it says the deliverance that comes from His face. It means the one who is with me, the one who is present, the one whose face I know, that one will save me. Do you see it? It means that God is present in that moment. And He's present in the salvation moment. God is so present. While my soul is downcast, I know that He'll save me. That's what He says. And he trusts God that if God would look with favor upon him, that God will intervene. And if God intervenes, everything will change. Fam, we must remind ourselves of God's grace, great salvation. Because we are Christians and we live after the cross, after the resurrection, after Pentecost, and before the redemption of all things, we live in this time called Christ, or the church and the Spirit. That is where we are at the moment on this 14th of July in 2024. We know of God's great salvation. And what we need when we're down can be described as gospel self-talk. We must not listen to the enemy. We must not listen to ourselves when we are downcast, but we must speak the gospel to ourselves when we are in these moments. And fam, the gospel starts with God's love. That's why it's good news. For God so loved the world. Not for God was so angry with the world, or God was so hungry for judgment with the world, or God's nose burned towards the world that he, for God so loved the world. That's where the gospel starts. God loves you. And he showed his love to you by sending his son. So that if you believe in him, that you will not perish. And the very next verse says, because God did not come to judge the world, but he came to save it. Jesus coming to earth and living the perfect life on our behalf, dying the death that we should have died, is a picture of God's faithfulness. Fam, in Genesis chapter 3, God says, someone from your seed will crush the head of the serpent. How many times does God renew his covenant? Through the Old Testament. And the prophets cry out, and the people cry out, and they keep on reminding themselves that God said he will send someone, and then he sent someone. God has always wanted to be with his people. He's always wanted to be in a relationship with his people. He made a way. That's the good news. That is the gospel. That was his great act of salvation, is the fact that Jesus suffered as a substitute for our salvation, and now it is done. That's the gospel. And when we are down, that is what we preach to ourselves. There's nothing more important than my relationship with God being repaired and reconciled. It's taken care of, praise Jesus. That is why I shall again, because he took care of it. It is enough for me. It is sufficient for me. This act of Jesus is worthy for me to hold on to and to build my life on. We can never lose sight of how awesome and beautiful the gospel is. And when we're down, then that's what we gaze at. Because God did act. And God did save. The psalmist says he will. We say he did. That's the difference in our position. So he's inviting us into this way of communing with God, which is beautiful. And we learn so much from him. Our message, the message that we preach to our own souls, is so much wider and deeper because God did act on his promises. And fam, if you are sitting here today as a Christian and you don't feel like the cross is enough, you don't feel like the cross is sufficient, you don't feel like the cross is the thing you can build your life on and hold on to, then gaze at the cross again and think of your salvation again. Simple exercise that I do is I try and think what my life would have been like if I wasn't saved 19 years ago. Fam, it takes me all of 3 seconds to go, whoa, dog show. And then I think of my salvation again. I think of where Jesus came to me. I think of where he met me. I think of that evening that I wanted to take my own life and he spared me from it, and here I am 19 years later. Knowing life, growing in his image, being part of his family, with all the gifts and privileges that he's given me. Praise God that he saved me that night. That's an exercise I do. How about you? Just think of your own salvation. You came from death to life, fam. You came from darkness to light. You came from slavery to freedom. You came from isolation to love and family. That's what you preach to yourself when you're down and out. Today might be that day for you. Today might be the day that you hear this word and that you go, okay, wait, I actually haven't accepted that invite, but I'm going to do it today. So think about it. I am going to ask you to do that later in the service. Look, you might scoff at the word self-talk. This feels like a how to pick yourself up kind of sermon. It's not. Look at what D. Martin Lloyd-Jones said. The main art in the matter of spiritual living is to know how to handle yourself.
You have to take yourself in hand. You have to address yourself. Preach to yourself. Question yourself. You must say to yourself, hope in God. Instead of muttering in this depressed, unhappy way. And then you must go on to remind yourself of God, who God is and what God has done and what God has pledged Himself to do. Then having done that, end on this great note. I love this. Defy yourself and defy other people and defy the devil and the whole world and say with this man, I shall yet praise Him, my salvation and my God. These two guys were beasts.
What a sermon!
That's why this person is cast down. He longs for God. Let's look at the second one. He's cast down because he's feeling overwhelmed and forgotten. Okay, so remembering Jordan, Hermon, Mount Mizar, and then a lot of water and a lot of metaphors with the incredible line, deep calls to deep. You guys ready? Let's look at them. So Mount Hermon is in the northeastern part of Israel. Beautiful mountains in that area. Snow and dew on the mountains eventually trickle down, and then they feed what is called the Jordan River, which runs in Israel north to south. So it's majestic and it's beautiful, but we gather from that it's far from Jerusalem. And this person is not near the temple. And as he's not near the temple, he's determined to remember God himself. I'm here now, I'm not there. But I'm going to remember who God is while I'm here. So he feels deserted, but he still cries out. Do you see it? And it's important for us to see that he cries out to God during this time. He goes back to water imagery. Look at verse 7. But this time he uses water to describe the feeling of being busy drowning. Do you see? Have gone over me. He feels overwhelmed. Now think about it, fam. Mountains with snow and with dew trickling down causes waterfalls. Waterfalls causes pools. Pools causes streams. Streams causes rivers. So there's just this rush of water. And there's this noise created by the water. And as it's rushing and as it's noisy, you get this feeling that it's far more, far heavier and far deeper than you could ever imagine. This person says, that's how I feel. It's chaotic. It's chaotic inside of me. I am overwhelmed by my emotions and by my mind and by this longing. That's what deep calls to deep mean. Do you know what deep calls to deep means? It's deep. Now, I'm serious. It sounds like I'm using a pun, but that's actually what it means. It means a deep, complex rush of emotions. Do you remember that song? The well-known Michael W. Smith song that we sing? As deep cries out to deep, we sing, come Lord Jesus. So it describes our emotion and then our response to it. Now amazing, look at the words. Whose waves is that? And whose waterfalls are that? God's. So this person says, even though I'm overwhelmed, even though there are far too many things going on, somehow you are sovereign over all of these things. It's not like the waves are surprising you. It's not like the waterfalls are surprising you. That'll preach. Do you realize that whatever you are going through at the moment is not surprising God? I sometimes act like that. I take something to God as if He doesn't know. Have you seen the trouble we are in? Yeah, Rainer, relax, dude. I see everything. And I know exactly where this whole thing is headed. Chill, dude. I've got this. That's what this person says. It's not better yet. Actually, spoiler alert, it's not going to get better. But he still says, you know of these waves and you know of these waterfalls, they come from you. And look at verse 8. Oh, this is the best part for me. In his despair, he remembers God's steadfast love. Oh, what a beaut. The Hebrew word is chesed. Google, what does chesed mean? Then you'll see the first 1 million hits says, chesed is such a complex word, we don't have one English word that can describe chesed. So is it like the love a parent has for a child? Yes. Is it like the love a spouse has for another spouse? Yes. Is it like the love a friend has for a friend? Yes. Is it like the love family has for family? Yes. Is it like the love a mother hen has for her chicks? Yes. It's all of those loves put together. And then the writer says, by day the Lord commands his steadfast love. Oh my word, all love I would ever need and the only love I would never need is found in him. He remembers that. And then he says, day and night, I experience God's care. I experience God's protection. I experience God's blessing. He sang praises to God and prayed to him morning and evening. Do you guys see it? Night and day. And who does he pray to? Does he pray to an abstract God? Does he pray to a God that's on vacation? No, he prays to the God of his life. He knows God. And that's why he prays to him day and night. That's why he remembers this love of God. Let's look at verse 9. I say to God, my rock. So there's more reflection on the character of God. And what is the character of God? My rock. That's what you need in chaos, is a rock to stand on. Have you ever jumped into a river and then you get taken by the river? I've had the privilege of doing whitewater river rafting on the Zambezi River. We went through 21 rapids. I fell out of the boat on 17 of them. Which means I almost died 17 times that day. Wow, that was fun. Do you know what you need when you come up out of the Zambezi? You just need a rock. The moment you get to that rock, all the water can keep rushing. It doesn't touch you. It's unbelievable. Like you go through this incredible rapid and just on the other side, you're standing on dry ground. And then it looks like a little water feature in your parents' house garden. But when you're in it, I really felt like I was going to die. So what you need in chaos is a place to stand firm. This writer says that place to stand firm in times of chaos is God himself. He knows God is his rock. He knows God is his refuge. And he's still perplexed by his situation. And then he laments again, asking, why have you forgotten me? I'm in a really tough position. I go into mourning. And not only have you forgotten me, but godless men are taunting me. I am dying here. That's what he says. And God, you're silent. Don't you care? Are you missing it here? That's where he is. He says his whole being, his bones are distraught. And then look at verse 11. Here comes the chorus again. While he's sitting in this feeling of desertion, when he's overwhelmed, what does he do? He preaches again to his soul. And fam, for us as Christians, the one thing that we can preach to ourselves in these times, listen to me, is that we who are in Christ are never abandoned. Christ will never leave us, nor will he forsake us. Christ cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? As he died on the cross for us, I already said that. But then he rose on the third day, and then he commissioned his disciples. And what did he say to his disciples? I am with you always. We are never alone. Jesus took the flood of judgment on himself so that we don't have to endure it. And because he gave up his life, we can say, Christ is my life. And then what does he preach? A new sermon? No, same sermon. Again. You have heard that it was said. Don't tell me that things are going to be okay. Okay. But I just want you to know that things are going to be okay. There's a song from Jen Johnson. It's going to be okay. I discovered it in December, I think. Fam! The title is so simple. And the message is so simple. But that song leaves me in tears every time I listen to it. And then I feel like a raisin all drained out and parched. Because of the tears that I've cried. Why? Because it's true. It's gonna be okay. And for us as Christians, we believe that. Our present hope says it's gonna be okay. Our future hope says it's gonna be okay. We are people of hope. He doesn't preach a new sermon. He preaches the same sermon. And that sermon says again, I will again praise. Let's look at the last one. Not only is he longing for God and longing for participation in worship, not only does he feel overwhelmed and forgotten, he wants deliverance. Save me. Everyone born in the late 80s, all of a sudden hears a song from Evanescence that we listened to when we were teenagers. Are you guys with me? Yeah. All the older folk go, what? And all the young folk go, what? And then everyone in between, late 30s, go, yeah, what a tune. He wants salvation. Save me. So five verses. Verses 1 to 4 is a lament. And again, with an intensified plea. He knows God is powerful. He knows God is able to vindicate him. He knows God can defend him. He knows God can prosecute the enemy. He knows God can deliver me. So that's why he says, vindicate me and defend me. And then he speaks again about the character of God. And what is the character of God described like here? He's calling him his refuge. Safe place. Place where nothing can harm or hurt. So you're my safe place, but I am in this position. Why have you rejected me? Same cycle. Here we go again. He still feels like he's mourning. And he's mourning because he's dissatisfied. And he's dissatisfied because he knows who his safe place is, but he is not in his safe place. And look at it. He goes from forgotten, verse 42, verse 9, to feeling rejected, 43, verse 2. Have you ever been there? Look at what he says in verse 3. Send your light. Oh, send your light. And send your truth. Let them lead me. Let them lead me. Let them bring me to your holy hill and to your dwelling. Let them bring me back to that place that I remembered in Psalm 42, verse 4, the place where I used to sing and praise with my people. Let your truth and your light take me back to that place. Light of God is the experience of God's redemption and the experience of God's rescue. You know, we have the saying, light at the end of the tunnel. What does that mean? That means something is coming that will help and will save. So he says, let your light guide me. That assurance that something will happen and that something will save me. God's truth speaks of his covenantal faithfulness to his people. The words that God spoke, the promises he made. So God, let your light lead me and let your truth lead me. Let those two things take me back to this place of joy. Look at verse 4. Then I will go to the altar of God, to God my exceeding joy. That's what I'm looking for. If you would save me, then joy will be restored. He says, I can even imagine how I will praise you with the lyre. He's got a picture in his head of what it's going to be like when salvation happens. And then in verse 5, he preaches to himself a final time. Same sermon, same chorus. Question, has his situation changed? It hasn't. But what's the difference? Now he's got hope. Now he's got hope. So it's a statement of faith. It's a statement of hope. It's a statement of believing who God is and the fact that God is present, even though my circumstances tells me something different. And how can this person keep on saying this? Because this person has a personal relationship with God. It's seen in the titles that he gives God. We've spoken about the living God. We've spoken about the face of God. His enemies say, "Your God." He speaks of my God, my living God, my rock, the God in whom I take refuge, God my exceeding joy. He knows God. And what brings him hope is that he preaches to himself who God is and what God has done. And for us as Christians, fam, that's what we do when we're down and out. We look at what he has done for us, and we know that he has rescued us. He's brought us to himself. And that will give us hope. So from the psalm writer, we see a longing, we see a feeling, and we see a wanting. If I can just show you the 3 points again. And what we see is that hope is the end result. Faith is where this psalm ends. Now, how should we respond? How should we respond? I want to offer a few responses. And let me communicate them to you. Think about them. Is this what I need to do in response to these psalms today? And if it is, at the end, I want to pray for you. Are you guys with me? Firstly, how should we respond? Lament. It's not the French word for cement. Lament. Honest prayer. This writer voices his frustration, he voices his confusion, he asks his questions, he laments. In the news group this week, when we sent you the invite for today, the first question was, are you honest when you speak to God? Maybe that's the place for you to start. Just be honest. This writer also prays faith-filled prayer. In all of this and everything he's going through, he expresses confidence in God. Because of God's character, because of the things that God did in the past, he goes on and he ends with faith and with hope. Can you guys see that you have lament and faith and hope in the same conversation? They are not mutually exclusive to one another. So start being honest in the way that you talk to God, so that you can be filled with faith and filled with hope because of who he is and what he's done. He's really not scared of your honesty. He knows what you think anyway. Are you with me? Uyangihloli siza uyangaz. We sang that earlier. Yeah, did I quote that correctly now? I did. Yeah. Maybe your next step today is to just think of the nature and the work of God. Sprinkled throughout this psalm is truth, fam. Truth of God's chesed, his steadfast love. Truth of his salvation. Truth of his nature. Truth of his light and truth. Truth about his light and truth. Truth about his sovereignty. God hasn't changed. The psalmist reminds himself of that. For us, Hebrews 13:8 says, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Maybe you just never think about that. And maybe today that's your next step. Is to say, I'm going to think about this. Third response is to remember past experiences. It's not nostalgia, fam. It's about remembering that you at some point experienced the power and the presence of God. Because that experience will remind you that God is still alive today. And past experiences give us hope for today and hope for tomorrow. Don't lose hope. Maybe your response is just to sing. This is a song after all, you know. And God's people will sing the song. And when they sing the song, then that stirs up faith. It's a praying song. It's a pleading song. It's not a jubilant song, but it's a song that is filled with faith. Maybe that's your next step. It's just sing it like you mean it. Mean what you sing and sing what you mean. You like that one? Maybe you need to preach to your soul. That really deep space where you're not allowing anyone in at the moment. He preached to his soul 3 times. Maybe it's time that you start doing the same. Because on this side of the cross, our greatest source of hope is the fact that Christ has risen. Do you know what preaching to your soul sounds like as a Christian? It sounds like this. Self, if God is for you, who can be against you? Self, nothing shall separate me from the love of Christ. Self, I will see the face of my Savior. Self, He will wipe away every tear from my eyes and death will be no more. That's how you preach to yourself. And lastly, maybe your response today is just to surrender. To say, I admit my sins. I don't know God personally, but I want to. So I believe that Jesus paid for my sins. And I'm going to confess Him as my Lord and Savior. Fam, my prayer for you after 53 minutes of preaching is that you would have a great thirst for God today, and that you will drink deeply from His delights, and that He may give you a great thirst for that day, the day that we hope in, the day that we see His face. If you want to respond in any of these ways, close your eyes, let me pray for you. Father God, it brings us so much comfort to know that You are not surprised by our feelings and our thoughts. And to know that You are around us, in front of us, behind us, and even inside of us through Your Holy Spirit. May our prayers be filled with faith. May we start being honest with You. I want to pray for my brothers and sisters who is going to take that as the next step today. That it would just bring so much breakthrough, release, and revitalization to their spiritual lives. Make alive what is dead, Lord Jesus. We sing, the resurrected King is resurrecting me. So bring faith and flourishing to parched souls and broken people. We pray that in Your name. I pray that we would never forget Your nature and Your work. O God, You are a God of steadfast love. What a joy to know You. And You showed us this love in Your Son. We think of Your nature. We think of Your sovereignty. Lord Jesus, we think of the fact that You are the same today, yesterday, and forever. We remember the good times, Lord Jesus. We remember our own salvation. We sing about it. Help us to sing it like we believe it. Help us to preach the good news to ourselves. And help us to speak those words with hope, conviction, and certainty. And if today is our day of salvation, oh Lord Jesus, I praise You for it. Thank You for being in the business of saving people. Thank You for bringing people from darkness to light. Thank You for calling people by name to be Your sons and daughters. We praise You, Lord Jesus. Receive our praise now as we respond in song. Amen.